I know what a world without nuclear weapons looks like. It's not a very nice world.
Catch this.
A new low-yield nuclear warhead has entered production in Texas, according to the National Nuclear Security Administration. The warhead, known as the W-76-2, is a low-yield weapon ordered in last year's nuclear posture review.
We believe that in order to deter Russia from using nuclear weapons on the battlefield, we should deploy a low-yield nuclear weapon on our ballistic missile submarines.
It makes no sense for us to build low-yield nuclear weapons. There is no advantage to that, and it is dangerously escalating.
Your mind goes to the idea that, yes, nuclear weapons become usable, and then we're really in trouble.
There is no such thing as a zero-calorie chocolate fudge sundae, and there's no such thing as a low-yield nuclear weapon.
The largest conventional weapon in the U.S. stockpile right now is this massive ordnance air blast bomb. And this one has a yield of 11 tons of TNT. What the administration now is trying to pursue and call a low-yield warhead is a warhead that is about 500 times more powerful than this bomb, 5,000 tons of TNT. So it's still massive in terms of the damage that it can do. My name is Sébastien Philippe. I'm a fellow at the Project on Managing the Atom at the Harvard Belfast Center for Science and International Affairs. I served in the French government as a nuclear weapons system safety engineer. It's not actually a completely new warhead design. The idea here is to modify the W-76-1 and so to remove the secondary from that warhead and simply keep the plutonium primary.
In other words, we'll take a big weapon out of a submarine and put a small weapon back in.
What is new here is to modify a weapon that is deployed on a strategic weapon system. So the ballistic nuclear submarine, taking one or two of those missiles out, removing the existing warheads and placing lower yield warheads on top of those missiles. But those missiles' mission would not be the usual strategic second strike capability mission.
It's to make certain that no one thinks that they could use a low yield weapon and put us in a position where we could only respond with a high-yield weapon, with the supposition that maybe we would not.
Now, who can argue with that?
This idea that we need a couple of like small nuclear weapons to show them we're serious, and then we'll use those and things will calm down and we'll all get back to our senses. It's a nice theory, but the problem is if it breaks down, life as we know it on the planet is over.
As many experts have publicly suggested, Russia may not be able to distinguish between an incoming Trident missile that poses an existential threat to their nation and a low-yield nuclear missile that is intended to serve more of a warning.
You know that on that submarines, there are strategic missiles armed with, you know, multiple hundred kilotons warheads. And you would not be able to see the difference. You may try to calculate as quickly as possible the trajectory, but you may not know. So during that time, if you want to take a decision, you may have the wrong information, or you may just assume that this is simply a strategic strike, and it's not just not as, you know, a one warhead coming at you.
If the Russians employ a low-yield nuclear weapon on the battlefield, and they see something coming out of the Trident coming their direction, it's nuclear. The question is, how big is that response? And they will find out in about 30 minutes. They will.
That may be a risk that this administration is willing to take, but it is not one that I can support.
The second problem is that the submarines, their core mission is really the second strike capability, so they're supposed to remain hidden and hide under the sea until one day the order comes that, you know, they need to retaliate. If you use one of those weapons for that submarine in particular, you would also kind of give up its position, because every time you launch a missile, it's kind of pretty clear you can, you know, track back the points of origin. And that submarine may be attacked also. And, you know, where does this end is something we can't really predict.
If an adversary employs low-yield nuclear weapons on a battlefield, the only option that we have should not be just to go big. If they believe they can achieve their objectives through the limited use of nuclear weapons, then we risk a deterrence failure.
If you're trying to use nuclear weapons to prevent escalation and a bigger nuclear war, you may actually, you know, accelerate that possibility rather than the other way around. If it's just a problem of yield, there is what the U.S. administration would call small or low-yield nuclear weapons currently in the arsenal. I think here it's more a matter of ideology, the way, you know, the United States sees the world and the relation it has to the world at this point, rather than something that is absolutely logical, that because Russia deploys a new weapon, we have to deploy a new weapon in response.
What disturbs me about the direction of this conversation is I don't believe that great power rivalry equals endless arms race. That basically, whenever you have a great power rivalry, all that is involved is military power. You have to build as much as you can build, they have to build as much as they build, and it goes up and up and up and up and up.
We will outspend and out-innovate all others by far.
The United States doesn't have to do that. The United States has the strongest conventional military in the world. It has strategic nuclear weapons that can deter any nuclear attack anywhere in the world. And if you think that's not the case, then you have a bigger problem. And it's not by fielding a 5-kiloton warheads on an SSBM that you're going to solve that problem.
What's your priority among our nuclear triad?
Well, nuclear is just the power, the devastation is very important to me.